Welcome to part 4 of Terraform for Java developers. I am Julien Dubois. You can follow me on Twitter at Julien Dubois, and I am leading the Java Developer Advocacy team at Microsoft. In this four-part series, we have been exploring Terraform for Java developers. You are currently in part 4, configure a Spring Boot and MySQL application with Terraform. So this is the last part. If you want to watch the other videos, they are available on our YouTube channel. So let's get back where we stopped on part 3. So we have improved our code by following some best practices, and we are ready to finish everything by adding a Java application server on top of our MySQL database. For this, we're going to use an Azure service called App Service. So App Service is a platform as a service provided by Azure. So in order to do that, I'm going to do the same thing as we did earlier for MySQL. I'm going to go to the documentation and type App Service. Here it is. And I'm going to be able to use that sample app as a starter. This one is going to be much more complicated than what we've seen earlier. So that's why it's going to be more interesting for that last part. So first of all, we've got two resources here. We've got an app service plan and an app service. So that is specific to app service. So the plan is basically the type of resource you will be using. So this will give you different options depending on the price you pay. You can have more powerful or less powerful servers depending on the plan that you are taking. The plan is described here, that's the SKU you are using. So let's first configure this part. So I need to give it a specific name. So I'm going to do like I did earlier, I'm going to use my ID init and let's call it plan to have something unique. I'm still having a location and resource group, which are the ones that I've been using from the start. And here for the SKU, well, that's specific to Azure. That's something you cannot guess without looking at the documentation. So the ones I will be using for Java are called Premium and P1 V2. So I recommend you to have a look at the documentation to take the right plan depending on your budget and on your needs. This one is pretty powerful. You probably don't need something like that. But as I'm doing a demo, I'm going to take a powerful solution. Again, thanks to Terraform, I'm going to be able to create this and destroy it very quickly. So price is not that much of an issue here. So I'd rather have something that works fast than something that is cheap. But that's because I'm doing a demo now. So that's the plan I'm going to use. And in that plan, I'm going to use an app service instance. This app service instance also needs to have a name. I'm going to do the same thing. I'm going to call it JDubois Pet Clinic. It's going to use also location, resource group, and it's going to use the ID of the app service plan we have created earlier. So that means that when Terraform will do its graph, as we have seen the graph in the previous section, it will first create the plan. That will create an ID for it. That ID will be used here for our app service instance. After that, we've got some specific configuration here. I'm going to give you my own configuration, and I'm going to explain to you why I think it's useful for Java developers. Here we are doing something which is specific to Azure, but which should benefit most Java developers because the options I'm going to use are very generic. Most clouds should have something similar. So first of all, I'm going to tell it that I want to use HTTP only because otherwise that will give me some security warning and I don't like that. I'm going to use this configuration attribute, which is called siteconfig, where I can give it the version of Linux I'm going to use. So here you can use app service either with Windows or Linux, and you have got different versions of Java in it. Let me just show you, for example, here, let's have a look at the different versions I can have with Linux. So for this, I need to use the easy command line, easy web app list runtimes Linux. So again, this is very specific to Azure. Your cloud provider will have something different, but this is giving me the runtimes that are available for app services on Linux. And as a Java developer, there are a few of them here which are interesting to me. I'm going to use Java 11 here. So again, you need to have a look at the documentation and be very careful here because that's where you can mess up or not. So I'm going to use Linux with Java 11. And if I want to use Linux in my app service, I also need to tell in my plan that I'm going to have Linux here. So I'm telling it, so the kind of service plan I'm using is on Linux. And here in my instance, I'm going to use this version of Java on Linux. Again, that's something you cannot guess. You need to work a little bit on that. But if you are using Azure, those are my recommendations at the moment. Of course, in the future, there will be probably Java 14, 15, 16, which will supersede Java 11. And after that, we can add here some environment variables that will be available for my Spring Boot application. So environment variables work on all cloud providers. What is interesting here is that I'm going to tell it to use some specific environment variables. The first one is Spring Profiles Active. So this is a specific environment variable that Spring Boot will understand. And that means that Spring Boot will use a MySQL profile. So if you remember, here we've got a specific MySQL profile that Spring Boot is going to use. So when I tell it to Spring Boot, that means Spring Boot will trigger that profile and will start to use MySQL, including with those properties. So I also need to override those properties. I can override them here, but that would not be very good because that means I would have the password in clear text here. I don't really like that. What you can do here, on the other hand, is override those variables as environment properties. So I'm going to use one, for example, for the data source URL. So let me copy-paste what I have here for the data source URL, username and password. And what you can see is that my data source URL is going to be my MySQL server.example.fully qualified name. It's going to use my database name. And then some more attributes. The important one to use here is use SSL equal true, because otherwise you will not be secured, which is of course really bad. To log in inside your database, you will use the administrator login that we have configured earlier. So, and it will be used to connect to our database server. And last but not least, we will have the database password that we have configured earlier, which is above here. So again, you should not have it clearly here, but you get the idea here. That's something you should generate randomly or something that you get from another service. Then it's passed here as environment variables so that nobody can see it. Now that I've configured all that, let's have a look with a blast radius to understand better what we have created here. So we can see it's a little bit more complicated now. Next to my MySQL database, I've got now an app service plan. And depending on that app service plan, I've got an app service. And that app service uses both the app service plan and the MySQL database. So indeed, we can understand here that Terraform is doing a graph of those resources. And having a tool like blast radius allows you to better understand what's going on when it's getting more complex. Otherwise, it's at some point, it's very complicated to understand what's happening. As I'm happy with that, let's do Terraform apply. So this is going to synchronize the current state of my Azure cloud with my desired state. So this is going to create the application server plan and the instance. So as we can see, it's going to add two things, which are my plan and my app service instance. Let's say yes. So it's going to generate everything. We will have a look a little bit later here in our Azure portal so we can see those resources being created here and we'll be able to access them. In the meantime, let's go back to our app. So what we have done at the moment is generate the whole infrastructure. So Terraform only does that. It's only creating resources. It is not a deployment tool. Well, you can use it to deploy your Java server, but it would not be the normal usage of Terraform. Its normal usage is just to generate your resources for you. And then when you need a way to deploy your applications to Terraform, for this, I'm going to use a specific Maven plugin. So I'm back to the Java world. I'm back to Maven. And let's just go at the beginning of the plugins. And I'm going to add a specific plugin for Azure. So this is not Terraform at all anymore. This is just Azure. And I'm going to add a new plugin group ID com.microsoft.azure, web app Maven plugin. So this is a specific Maven plugin created by Microsoft to deploy to Azure. So I'm going to use this to deploy my application to the cloud that we have just configured. I'm just going to copy paste the configuration for this here. And we're going to have a look at the configuration. So what I'm telling it is I want to deploy my app to a specific resource group. So this needs to be the same one as the one we have configured with Terraform. So my resource group, let me just go here, is this one. So let's copy paste the resource group. And it's going to deploy to that app service instance. So we have created it here. It's called TMP Jijibua Pet Clinic. So let's go there. And just with those changes, this plugin should be able to deploy my application to Azure and to the infrastructure that we have just described. Let's have a look at our code. So it has been created. Let's go back to the portal to refresh it. Indeed, we have our plan here and our application service, which is here. We can click on it. So currently there's nothing. We have not deployed any code. So if I click here, it will be a welcome page. Now let's use Maven first to package our code. And once our code is packaged, we'll be able to deploy it using the Maven plugin. So we're going to have a small error here because of check style. So, that's specific to this application, but you will get it, whatever the application you use, of course. We'll have some specifics to all applications. So Spring Pet Clinic is using check style to validate the code that you have done, and it does not understand Terraform. So I'm just going to tell it to ignore Terraform here. Terraform. And so check style will be happy, and I will be able to package my app again, this time without any error. So if you get a check style error because of Terraform, just remove it. So let's package the app again and let's deploy it. So our app is packaged. Now let's use Azure plugin to deploy it. Here it is, Azure web app. Deploy. And so our application has been deployed to Azure. Let's just go back to the Azure portal. Here is our application. Let's go to the logs so we better understand what is happening. So here we're going to see our application being deployed, connecting to the MySQL database, and then being available. Here it is, we can see it's being created. So we can see here the application being deployed. It's connecting to the data source. And as soon as it is ready, we can refresh our application here. And we will see the application being available in production. Here it is. I can now have a look at the owners of my pets. And this is connecting, of course, to MySQL. So what we have seen here is how to create the whole infrastructure for our Spring Boot application using Terraform. Again, it's mostly a matter of correctly configuring everything here. And most of the time is spent in the end having a look at the specific attributes for our resources, like the version of your resource that you want to use, the type of resource that you need. That needs some work, but as we have seen, it's very easy to destroy and create resources thanks to Terraform, and it's also very easy to share them with your colleagues. Once everything is done and everything is running, as we have now, so now it's very easy for me to destroy my Terraform infrastructure, and so it's not going to cost me any money anymore. That's also why I'm using some better application server here, because they are only running for a few minutes. So I'd rather have something performant and go fast, as it's not going to cost me a lot of money. So I just typed yes, it's going to destroy everything, and my whole resource group will be destroyed. Again, if you have any issue here with Terraform, you can also destroy the resource group manually. You just go to the Azure portal and you destroy it manually here by deleting the resource group. So you don't have anything running after having done this exercise. Let's just wait a little bit to see this running. And everything is destroyed. So as we have seen, it's very easy to create and destroy and also modify the state of my infrastructure thanks to Terraform. Let's just go back to my resource group here just to show that it's all destroyed and there's nothing anymore. If I refresh the whole thing, it's even going to have an error. So everything has been destroyed, which is what I wanted. That's cool. So if you want to know more about Terraform, well, if you want to have a look at my script, you can go to my gdbois/petclinic GitHub repo. Everything is under the deploy to Azure branch. I have done a specific branch to work on, so here it is. I will post it, of course, in the comments of this video. And you've got some basic instruction here to create your cloud, your infrastructure, and deploy it with Azure. Thanks a lot. I hope you have enjoyed this series of video on Terraform for Java developers. And I hope you will come back to see more videos on the Java on Azure YouTube channel. Thank you.